Good morning. Today, I would like to talk about the food legislation, which is the part of the Green Skills module. First of all, I would like to talk about the importance of food regulations. There are two basic important role of food regulations. One of them is to provide the safest and the healthiest food for consumers. The other is promote fair trade. As we know that Codex standards are the benchmark standards for food safety, so it also protects the health of the consumers, it ensures fair practices in the food trade, and it promotes coordination of all food standards undertaken by IGOs and the INGOs. And right now, almost all countries are the member of the Codex Alimentarius. But when we look at the nature of the Codex Alimentarius, we can say that Codex standards, which is known as the book of the food standards, are not obligatory. Each Codex text are recommendations, and therefore each country decides how to apply it, and it is used by millions worldwide. And since there is a close relationship between the Codex and the WTO, each Codex standards are referred in WTO SPS agreement and the TPT agreement, on which I will talk about later. But the most important thing is that Codex Alimentarius encourages countries for harmonization of their national regulations with the international regulations. Therefore, it opens the markets for new product development. And we can say that it is the invisible relationship between the producers, consumers, and all actors in the food chain. Codex has different volumes on the electronic text, and each of them can be available in the website. As I said before, almost all countries are the members of the Codex Alimentarius, and Codex decisions are based on science. So it has risk assessment and risk management bodies. Risk management Codex Alimentarius Commission is responsible from the risk management, but is known as risk management body. However, it has different risk assessment bodies. For example, GMPR can be given as an example, and it is known as joint FAO WHO meeting on pesticide residues. So it takes decisions about the use of the pesticide. So all of the decisions about the food standards are based on science. As I said before, it has a lot of members, and European EU is also member of the Codex, and international non-governmental organizations and the governmental organizations are also member of Codex Alimentarius. Here you can see the Codex Alimentarius Commission. It has a general committees, which is known as horizontal, and it has a vertical committees and also ad hoc intergovernmental task forces. The website, here you can see the website of the Codex Alimentarius, which contains information about the list of the standards, guidelines, or meetings, and each of them can be available using the website. As I mentioned before, there is a close relationship between the WTO and the Codex, and here you can see the website of the World Trade Organization. Actually, World Trade Organization has two important agreements. One of them is known as SPS agreement. The other is known as TBT agreement. SPS agreement is known as agreement on the application of sanitary and phytosanitary measures. So if there is a concern about the food safety, in this case, the rules are defined by SPS agreement. But if there is a technical technical barriers to trade, or if there's an issue about the trade. In this case, the rules about the use of product are covered by TPTA agreement. So, similar to Codex, both SPS and the TPTA agreements calls all countries to harmonize their regulations with the international regulations. WTO has three sisters, which saw OECD, which is known as World Organization for Animal Health Interest with Animal Health, IPPC, which is known as International Plant Protection Convention, is interest about the plant health, and Codex concern about the human health, as I said before. Since TBT agreement interests about the trade, so it covers much more standards as compared to SPS agreement. Here you can see the website of the EU food regulation. What is the difference between the EU food regulation and Codex? Actually, EU food regulation has similar purpose. So EU food regulation also is concerned about the safety food. EU food regulation promotes the safety for food for the consumers, and also ensures fair trade. But EU food regulation is much more firmer as compared to Codex Alimentarius, Codex standards. EU legislation is actually essential to trade, and similar to Codex, again, it follows the WTO rules and therefore SPS and TBT agreements. And it has a general law, which is known as 178. And this general food law defines all of the rules for the use of other regulations, specific regulations. And it has a direct rate of general health and food safety, which is known as DG SATE. And it is an official control body, which is known as Food and Veterinary Office. And also, it is a risk assessment and a risk management body. So EU food regulation is based on size similar to Codex. And European Commission and the Parliament is, of course, risk management body. But European Food Safety Authority is risk assessment body. So European Food Safety Authority gives advice to Commission and member states. How food regulation is prepared? If the first of all, if food signal, food safety signal should come either from the European Food Safety Authority or from a member state. And after that, a proposal is prepared by European Commission and the member states. Then discussion on the proposal, there will be a discussion about the proposal in the export committee between the European Commission and the member states, and there will be voting on the proposal in the standing committee on plants, animals, food and feed. And proposal presented after the voting, if it is accepted, of course, proposal presented to European Council and the Parliament. As I said before, European Food Law Regulation, which is known as 178, defines all of the rules for the use of the other specific regulations. So, similar to Codex, we can actually differentiate regulations into categories, which are known as horizontal regulations and the vertical regulations. Horizontal harmonization or horizontal regulations cover all foodstuff. On the other hand, vertical harmonization is much more actually about the detailed specification. So it gives detailed information about the specific food products. For example, if we interest with the olive oil, it will be, I mean, the rules defined in vertical regulations. And if we, for example, interest with the methods of sampling or analysis, in this case, we can talk about the horizontal harmonization. Similar to Codex, European food safety policy is about the food hygiene, animal health, plant health, but also it interests with contaminants and the residues. Now, I would like to talk about a specific regulation, which is known as 1169. This regulation is very important for the consumers because it provides the safety food products. So consumer looking at the label, consumer can decide and can understand whether the product is misleading or not misleading. So 1169 defines the rules about the use of the food label. This regulation is known as the provision of food information to consumers. And food information shall not be misleading, particularly the characteristic of food, by suggesting that the food poses specific characteristic when all similar foods poses such characteristic. By suggesting the presence of a particular food or an ingredient, while a component naturally present or an ingredient normally used has been substituted with different components or different ingredients, food information should be accurate, clear, and easy to understand for the consumer. So food information should not be mislead the consumer. There are, of course, some mandatory particulars which should be found on the label. This can be classified as name of the food, list of ingredients, allergens, quantitative indication, net quantity of the food, etc. But the red ones, name of the food, net quantity of the food, alcoholic strength, should be presented on the same same size of the label. And there's also quantitative ingredient declaration. So the rules about the quantitative ingredient declaration, which is known as QID, also defined in 1169 regulation. And when QID is mandatory, if ingredient appears in the name of the food or is usually associated with that name by the consumer, in this case, QID is mandatory. For example, we have four chicken vegetable pies. In this case, QID is mandatory for chicken and vegetables. And if ingredient is emphasized on the labeling in words, pictures, or graphics, in this case, QID is again mandatory. Here we have an example, which actually, looking at the label, we can see olive oil as a word and also as a picture. So QID is mandatory for olive and olive oil. Here, we have another example. Ingredients is essential to characterize a food and to distinguish it from products with which it might confuse because of its name or appearance. For this case, we don't have much example. We have a very few example. One of them is marzipan, and we know that marzipan can be found in different member state countries, and we know that marzipan should contain hazelnut. In order to not mislead consumer, in this case, the quid is mandatory for the hazelnut. How quid is presented on the label? It can be expressed as a percentage, or it can appear either in or immediately next to the name of the food, or in the list of ingredients. Here we can see the example. For example, we have a fruit yogurt, and we can see also fruit on the picture. And in this case, quid is mandatory for the fruit because we know that we have a fruit yogurt, and quid is used in ingredient list. Here we also we have another example, and this example in this example we can see also quid in ingredient list. If we have a yogurt with cereals, in this case quid is quid is mandatory for cereals. If we have fruit pie, in this case, fruit is mandatory. Quid is mandatory for fruit. Here we can see that quantitative indication of quid of ingredients is recorded, where the ingredient or category of the ingredient is emphasized on the labeling in words, pictures, and graphs. Here we can see pictures. Here we can see words, and therefore each of the ingredients are mandatory to be used on the label. We have a marzipan example. We used the marzipan example for this case. Okay, on this slide. Sometimes quid is not required in respect of certain ingredients or category of ingredients, which appearing in the name of the food, the variation in the quantity is not essential to characterize the food. Here we have a cornflakes example. We have a cornflakes, and we know that it should contain corn. Therefore, there is corn quid is not mandatory for corn. Regulation 1169 also defines the rules about the allergens and the intolerant substance causing allergens and intolerances. All of the substance resulting in allergens and intolerances should be highlighted using the different font, style, or background color. Here we can, have different example. For example, on the label, they used the they emphasized allergen name using the contains word. Here we have a similar example for this one. However, in this on this label, we can see different color for we can see. That the producer used different color for allergens, which are wheat, celery, and cream, which can be obtained one of the allergen. Here you can see the EU list of the allergen, which is defined again in the 1169 regulation. And as I said before, each of the allergen should be emphasized on the label in different colors or in different styles. Sometimes we can use some derivative which can be obtained from the one of the allergen allergen substance in the product. In this case, again, derivative should followed by allergen name. Here you can see the examples for this. For example, tahini is obtained from the sesame, which is one of the allergens defined in regulation 1169. So we should highlight the allergens, and we should use derivative which followed by allergen name. Sometimes emphasis of the allergen is not required. For example, if we have a dry roasted peanuts, as you can see on the label, they use the allergen name, which is peanuts. So there is no need again for the emphasis of allergen on the product and product label. Another thing is that sometimes we, sometimes we can emphasize allergens using the contents statement. For example, in this case, we have a wine, and wine contains sulfite. In this case, we don't have an ingredient list because it is a wine. So we should use contents statement, and we can understand looking at the label, we can understand that sulfite is allergen. Also, another specific case, sometimes we can emphasize the same allergen for different times. Here you can see that milk is emphasized for two times, but because the product contains milk and lactose, which is produced from milk, derivative example, as I said before. So for both of times, we should emphasize allergen name. Sometimes we can have allergen boxes. Sometimes allergen advice boxes will disappear. In this case, the producer can be used a statement: food allergens are highlighted in the ingredient list. 1169 also defines the rule to use of the food additive in the ingredient list. So according to 1169, we can use either E number or the name of the food additive. So for example, if a product which contains the food for potassium sorbate, in this case we can use potassium sorbate as a word in the ingredient list, or we can only use the E number. However, if there is a concern about the allergen, we should use full name with the E number. So we cannot use only E number. We should use the full name. Therefore, in this case, E number does not mean anything. So if there is a concern about allergen, I should highlight that we should use full number. Sometimes we can use allergens in different forms. For example, we can use either sulfates or sulfites or sulfur dioxide to show allergen substance. Sometimes we can use picture declaration instead of word declaration. Here we have a product which is known as strawberry jelly in powder, and here you can see the ingredient list, which contains the gelatin, sugar, strawberry flavoring. So I would like to ask, is the product compliant with allergens label requirements? The answer is no, because we have a strawberry flavoring, and we don't know that whether this flavoring is obtained from one of the substances which causing allergens or intolerances. Now I would like to talk about the voluntary food labeling, because when we are considering about the vegan or vegetarian labeling. We cannot talk about mandatory labeling because mandatory means that information must be included by law. Right now, there is no mandatory definition about vegan or vegetarian labeling. But sometimes the producers or the main, producers can use voluntary information if they think it could be useful for consumer or if they want to increase their if they want to increase their selling of products. In this case, they can use voluntary labeling. Here you can see the nutritional claim and health claim. I will talk about both of them later. These two type of claims are also can be used voluntarily by the manufacturers. For the vegan labeling and vegetarian labeling, we can of course we should discriminate both of type. Both of labeling type because we define the vegetarian labeling as the food does not contain any animal products or additives from animal sources such as gelatin. For the vegan labeling, we say that the food does not contain any animal products, including those from living animals like milk. Therefore, if we want to use voluntarily vegan labeling. In this case, we can use such a logo. These are the examples for the vegetarian logos. Okay. As I said before, 1169, of course, set out rules for the voluntary labeling. However, as I mentioned before, there is no mandatory rules about the vegan or vegetarian labeling. And also there is a ISO standards, which define also the rules about the voluntary labeling of, for vegetarian and for vegans. Now, I would like to talk about another important regulation, which is known as food additive. Regulation 333 is actually a package regulation that includes the other regulations. 331 is actually about the food additives, enzymes, and the flavoring. 332 is about the food enzymes and the 334 is about the flavoring. So this 333 is a very comprehensive regulation and it contains higher than 100 pages. Food additives can be can be defined as any substance not normally consumed as food in itself and not normally used as a characteristic ingredient of food. So food additives intentionally added for a technological purposes, for example, to give color, to give flavor, to give texture to product. And as I said before, it's a very comprehensive regulation. So it has different annexes and each of annex defined the different roles of food, each food additive. And there is also database and which shows all of the additives and the foods which are right now to be a lot used. And here you can see the examples for the food additive and we have an ingredient list. And for example, we have a carrageenan and we know that it's defined as food additive and it is used as stabilizer. We have another example, for example, citric acid, which is used as to give acidity to product. Now, I would like to talk about another important regulation, which is known as food supplements. Food supplements can be defined are products which in concentrated forms of nutrients, having nutritional and or psychological impacts, are sold as a complement to a typical diet. So it is not part of our diet, but it is just a complement of our diet, and it can be found in different forms, such as in the tablet form, capsule form, or liquid form. And each rule, including also labeling requirements, here you can see, are defined in Directive 2002. 46. And now I would like to talk about the nutrition and health claim. The rules for the nutrition, the use of nutrition and health claims again is defined in Regulation 90/24. What is the nutrition claim? It can be defined as any claim, states, suggests, or implies that a food has a specific positive nutritional qualities because of the energy, nutrients, or other substance supplied, not supplied, or supplied in a reduced, increased amount is called as nutritional claim. Here you can see the examples for the nutritional claim. And as I said before, to use of the nutritional claim, of course, we should obey the rules which is defined in Regulation 90/24. For the health claim, we can say that health claim states, indicates, implies that there is a link between a food category, a food, or one of the its contents and one's health. So here you can see the example. For example, this shows that it is clinically proven to have reduced cholesterol. So it's a health claim, but to use this such a health claim, of course, the product should be a complement to Regulation 90/24. This slide actually concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your attendance.